So welcome back everybody again here. I hope you all had a great lunch. So welcome everybody to Voice of Healthcare Conference. First day started in 2015 and it has been really very exciting Voice of Healthcare for we in the vast ocean of healthcare. We have been carefully moving and navigating our path to our destination that is affordable and quality health for all, healthy and financial health for all stakeholders of healthcare industry. Captain of the ship are Dr. Naveen Nishil, Mr. Afzal Kamal, and Mr. Manish Rastogi. Further, I would like to call for the panel discussion. We start this conference with a panel discussion on medical devices and equipments. We hope some of the thoughts for our panelists would be like find renounce engine for the future government politics on medical equipments and devices. So I would request Dr. Salil to please come up on the stage. I would like to request Mr. Sumit Marwah to please come up on the stage. Mr. Jatin Mahajan, MD and J. Mitra and Company Private Limited. Ms. Mala Vazirani to please come up on the stage for further discussion. I would request all these panelists to please come.
It's fine.
I would also request Dr. Chimote to please come up on the stage.
Mr. Sumit is here, Mr. Chimote.
Okay. Also, I would request Dr. Abhijeet Dashetwar to please come up on the stage and be a part of the panelists. I would request Dr. A.C. Chimote, if he's present here, I would request him to please come down at the stage.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting us to be here in the panel discussion for medical devices, regulations, and price control. As we are aware that health is a precondition, an outcome, and an achievement of sustainable development goals. And one of the important pillars of sustainable development is universal health coverage. And as we know, one of the lagging behind area in the universal health coverage is the access to medical devices. These medical devices may range from diagnostic devices like a CT scan machine, a therapeutic device like a dialysis machine, an assistive device like a spectacle like I'm wearing, or a protective device like a condom. And believe me, the access of medical devices is very, very important, and it was pertinently proved in the 2013 survey done by WHO on the country capacity survey. The country capacity survey for non-communicable diseases showed that only 9% of the low-income countries had access to screening devices for non-communicable diseases and 92% access for high-income diseases, high-income countries. And the mortality ratio for cervical cancer, which is an outcome for non-communicable diseases, was almost 10 times the availability of medical devices, which has a direct link. Apart from access to medical devices, the two important pillars for medical devices is safety and affordability. And this is why we are here to discuss the two important topics for the medical devices safety and price regulation, which is one of the top line agenda in the medical devices world. So to begin with, we have Mr. Jatin Mahajan, Managing Director of J. Mitra, who is the leading manufacturer for IVDs in the country. So maybe we can start with the how do you see the price regulations that has come into play? What are the challenges and advantages you feel that the IVD industry in the country would have? Maybe. Can you share that, Mike?
Hello. Yeah, good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank the Voice of Healthcare to give me an opportunity to share my thoughts. Well, the IVD industry right now is at a very nascent stage. And as most of you are aware, that the Medical Device Rules 2017 has come into effect from this year, January 2018. So as far as the challenges are concerned, yes, I would say that yes, a lot of challenges are there. Firstly, you know, with respect to the definition of the medical device rules, which is tied to the definition of drugs. Till date, you know, as far as the industry is concerned, we have been telling the government that you know the rule should become a law, because you know that will give a better impact. Because right now what is happening is that the definition of the medical the rules is tied to the drugs. So what happens is, in effect, the repercussions will be with respect to the other laws which are existing right now. So under the other laws, we have the DPCO, which is under the Essentials Commodities Act, and under that we have 22 notified medical you know devices, under which you know we come under the NPPA. So as far as the IVD is concerned, we have the HIV, which the hepatitis B, the hepatitis C, the blood grouping seras, which are basically the notified. So we, in effect, have to give all the information to NPPA. But this should not be the case, because diagnostics is a different model altogether. It's a B2B model. We don't deal directly with any of the customers. We deal directly only with the pathology labs, hospitals. So that is a challenge. Somebody from the government needs to understand that this is not a B2C, it's a B2B model. And therefore,
a very good point made by my colleague, and it is very important to analyze that medical devices, as per global medical device nomenclature, are 15,000 in number categories, and each medical device works in a different business model, and it will be very important to see which business model are we targeting when we are going ahead with regulations. And Mr. Mahajan specifically spoke on the IVD industry. We also have Mrs. Mala Vazirani with us, who is MD for one of the biggest manufacturers of medical devices in the country, Transasia. Mrs. Mazirani, I would like to have your views on a larger perspective. How do you see medical devices regulations in the country playing an overall role for the medical devices, and not particularly on a specific domain? How do you see the Indian medical device manufacturer benefit from it, or the challenges?
I think if you compare to the rest of the world, there is a lot of confusion in our country regarding medical devices. And medical devices are important because they help the country deliver the essential medical care to the population. Now, this care has to be delivered in a safe manner, because there are risks associated with healthcare and there are risks associated with medicine, and therefore countries that have regulation take into account the kind of risks to the patient and to the user while regulating these medical devices. Now, we have no such approach here. Second, the other thing that countries regulate is the companies that operate in their market, because that is essential in a largely in context of countries where there is a lot of labor that needs employment. And since the medical care budgets of many countries is significant, they use this to generate jobs in their country. So they want companies that create jobs, that are manufacturing in their country, to have the first the priority in servicing their market. Now, and they control this through various measures, through various means, either overtly or covertly, through laws like they have through FDA or other medical device regulations or certifications, etc., etc. For example, the USA will control the medical device business in their country under the guise of the US FDA and the 510K pre-market approvals. Now, we don't have any such controls on our markets. And as a result of which, our markets are in a way either becoming dumping grounds for machines which have been sort of seen their best days, end of life machines, entering the market here and exploiting customers who don't know about these machines, and the fact that they're very close to becoming obsolete because the electronics in them becomes obsolete. So, and then those operators will sort of create all the cloud around the pricing, which will of course not be a correct pricing, will not reflect the actual worth or value of a new machine, but will compete with brand new machines in the market, either imported or made in India for whatever reason in our local markets. So these are the things that need to be addressed by policy. And once we address those issues and we know what, it's a huge responsibility to deliver healthcare to over a billion people. And it's going to tax the budget of any country, even the richest countries, let alone our country. So if we don't really find a way to get this care and these devices and all the services, medical services linked to this whole provision of healthcare to the patient at a reasonable cost, or the government is ambitious to give it free, then it's going to be just a dream. It will never be delivered.
No, two very important points that Madam made was, one was that the job creation part, and that is something we obviously very much care about. And the other point Madam that made was the free flow of medical devices, which could actually play an important role in the safety of medical devices. We also have Rama Venugopal, Madam, who is the Executive Director of Value Added Services Corporation and has been a voice for entrepreneurs in the country. Rama, Madam, my question to you would be, how do you see these regulations coming into play? What are the main hindrances these probably entrepreneurs could feel, or actually this is, or you feel that this is a mandatory thing to actually stop the entrepreneurs who are not serious about the business? Your thoughts on this?
Yeah, good afternoon. See, I would like to look at it from the Make in India manufacturing campaign that is happening in the country. And but when you actually go back to the entrepreneurs, I'm talking about the young enterprises, and I'm talking about the startups. I'm talking about the biomedical engineers who have a dream to set up their own enterprise in this medical devices domain. The campaign is happening, Make in India, Make in India, but is it really gaining momentum in the country? No, it is not the case. Because when you talk to this budding entrepreneurs, the startups, the young enterprises, they all have one grievance, because they have a big dream to make some good medical devices in the country, which should be used in the country, and all the doctors should use it, and the hospitals should use it, and the consumers should prefer the medical devices manufactured in the country. We are setting up medical devices manufacturing parks. We are setting up business incubation centers. We are setting up centers of excellence for medical electronics, saying that we are encouraging startups. But I don't see this happening in the true spirit, honestly, because I don't see the startups crossing their business incubation period. I personally feel that they get choked, they get killed in the incubation stage itself. Where is the motivation and encouragement for the startups? Many biomedical engineers, I'm coming from South India, I go to a lot of colleges for career counseling, and I visit business incubation centers. We do a lot of mentoring. Lots and lots of biomedical engineers have bright ideas, great ideas. They want to come out with innovative products and solutions. But where is the market for them? The market is full of confusion on so many things happening, where the Make in India is never encouraged, and nobody is there to support a Make in India cause, a Make in India momentum. And then as a country, if we cannot create startups and micro enterprises now in this domain, we will never see large enterprises. We may not see a HMD, or we may not see a GN Mitra, or we may not see the brands like what we are seeing today. If we don't have the the micro and the small and the young enterprises today. We will never have a large enterprises, and medical devices is gaining a lot of momentum in the country, and I think it's high time that the government even should come out with a clear-cut startup policy to encourage new initiatives and new startups in this space.
No, a very good point. In fact, we're serious about promoting the entrepreneurs. We're serious about bringing in new players into the field, which could be maybe immature in the sense, but it's also important to have a perspective from a healthcare provider, a doctor, what he actually feels about. So we also have Dr. Abhijeet with us, who is MD of Redbulb Technologies with us, who is the voice of the doctors here. Dr. Abhijeet, what do you feel? How do you balance it out? We also have to promote the entrepreneurs. We also have to enable newer players to come in. As Rama Madam made a very important point, until and unless we promote these smaller players, they won't be able to come up as Transasia or as the HMD. What is your take on that as a service provider? How confident do you feel when you hear this?
To answer this question, I think my right introduction would be, I'm also a practicing cardiothoracic surgeon in Century Hospital in Hyderabad. And I was also part of public procurement system for nearly 12 years in the state of Andhra Pradesh and now Telangana. I remember my last, one of the most violent and rather destructive 3.5 months of tenure when I was working for working on one of the projects with Telangana State Medical Corporation for procurement of certain equipment, which for which the allocated budget was nearly 475 crores. After Telangana state was formed, the government of Telangana allocated nearly 475 crores for the hospitals to be upgraded. And as a one of the nodal officer, my biggest challenge was to how to define each of these equipment. See, being cardiothoracic surgeons, the kind of precision that we look at in the equipment that we use matters a lot, because we are sometimes operating on a coronary artery which is just a millimeter or millimeter and a half size. And I remember one such episode where I had lot of argument which I had to face was putting US FDA clause onto a cautery machine. And I'm sure a lot of panelists here may not agree, but believe me, it took me 9 meetings to convince my management why I had to put US FDA as one of the important clause in the cautery machine. Because today you have cautery machines being manufactured every nook and corner of Mumbai, Delhi and many places, and we do not have any kind of accreditation body which can tell me, yes, as an end user I can rely on this machine. See, the same machine at we actually look at energy either 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 or 10, 20, 30, 40. You use something like ValiLab. When I'm using a name, it is not that I am biased or I'm towards a particular brand, but just to give you an example, I'm using a ValiLab cautery machine on a 20 energy level and using another locally made cautery machine on a 20, the kind of charring that you see is, there's a hell lot of a difference. You know, that makes us worried. Any kind of regulation, I think, if can bring in these kinds of quality measures to give us the good product, I think as an Indian, we would always promote and would like to use Make in India products.
Good. Thanks for your views. Maybe I'll have Mr. Rajiv Nath's views on this at a later stage. I'm sure he's very excited to respond. But I'm sure this is why we actually need regulations in India. And this is, maybe we also recall our times when we were residents and we were at a learning stage, and how regulations could be very pertinent to say. And to maybe counterbalance, and I'm not sure how another doctor on my right would take it. So we have Mr. Anirudh. We have Mr. Sumit Marwah with us. So maybe, who's a CEO and director of Dispoline India Private Limited. Maybe I would request you to respond to what a fellow colleague just responded to on that.
Sure. I'm not disagreeing with what he said in principle, that he needed some kind of a body to tell him whether this product that he wants is in a way suitable in all forms for his usage. Now, just to take a step backward, in India we have a very oxymoronic relationship as healthcare device manufacturers with users and with the regulators. You know, if I may say, you know, there is a saying in Hindi or Urdu which says ke tujhe hi gale laga ke teri hi shikayat karne ko dil karta hai, which I want to embrace you, let yet complain about you. The new medical device rules that have been formed, I think so, would give a very great base for users in the healthcare space and for everybody else to now say, this is the basic, these are the minimum guidelines required for you to sell your product in India, whether you are importing it or manufacturing it. So your manufacturing sites shall be visited by none other than notified bodies under NABCB. You shall be checked for all parameters. The entire schedule is based on ISO 13485, which is a globally recognized medical device standard. So this first step is very important, and it has taken, to the best of my knowledge, if I remember, November 2008, Dusseldorf over some namkeen and chips. If I'm not wrong, that was the year that Mr. Rajiv decided to do IMED in Dusseldorf. And we need to all work together to understand what the user needs, what the healthcare manufacturers can provide, and what the regulators need to check. And the medical device rules, and it is so sad, and I'm saying this with a lot of humility, so sad that I met so many manufacturers today morning who haven't even heard of these medical device rules, which are actually implemented as of 1st January 2018. So they haven't even heard of them. They're saying, "Acha, karna hai hame abhi ab." So there are, so we have to also look within that as manufacturers, and I know of even implant manufacturers who have taken stay orders on these. So we need to, I think, so look within, and I'm not disagreeing with what Rama ma'am said, but entrepreneurs in India do business in spite of the government more often than not. So I think so it's a mixed bag, but the medical device rules and its implementation, I think so, will take this thing that you have, that where do I look for, in a great deal forward. We do not need US FDA, we do not need CE marking, we do not need the Japanese to teach us how to do medical devices. As manufacturers, forget the exports part, it's a different story, that comes with competence. We should be able to regulate this for 1.25 or 1.3 billion people in India. What more huger market do you need? And that's important, that this medical device rules should take that thing away from you in the future, is what I feel.
No, in fact, you did a wonderful job of a moderator, in fact, concluding what everyone said and bringing all of us to a point. And believe me, one point that we've probably missed out in this discussion so far has been, we've been talking about safety regulations, but the price regulation is something that we haven't touched upon. We have a very unique person with us in our panel. We have Mr. Gopa Kumar, who comes from Aidan, and he is the patient's voice, what we can call. And it will be very interesting to have his perspective. We've had manufacturers say what they feel about these regulations. We've had the entrepreneur's voice, what they feel about. We have a doctor's voice, what they feel about these regulations. But it will be very important to have a patient's perspective on that, more specifically on the price regulations that we recently had on a couple of medical devices. Dr. Kumar, Gopa Kumar, over to you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. From a public health perspective, if you look at what we require as a citizen of this country, I need access to quality healthcare, and most supposed to be free, if not at an affordable price. So how do you ensure them? Then all the inputs which require for the healthcare should be available at an affordable price. Medicines, medical devices, consumables, or even biotherapeutics, everything should be available at an affordable price. Then you can ensure an affordable healthcare. So therefore, how do you ensure availability? you should have competition in the market and also self-sufficiency. A country like India, which is a huge market, so you need competition and self-sufficiency. Because without self-sufficiency, you cannot have a competition in the domestic market, because if you are depending on importation, then importers can gang up together and threaten your government. That can compromise the health security of this country. So therefore, self-sufficiency is important. So how do you ensure self-sufficiency? You should have a set of policies which ensure to promote domestic manufacturing, which is critical. And when you look at these policies, so we are supposed to have a medical device policy, but that's not enough. The self-sufficiency can be ensured not only through a sector policies, but your macro policies should serve these purposes. Your technological policy, your FDA policy, your credit policy, all should be subservient to the purpose of making making self-sufficiency in the area of medical devices and other products. So this is not a theoretical thing. This is what exactly India did it in 1970s to ensure self-sufficiency in pharmaceuticals. Why we cannot do it in other two sectors, especially in the area of, if you classify the diagnostics as a separate entity. And all the scientific and technological push we give in the 80s for diagnostics, everything went off after the liberalization of 90s, and we became very import dependent. So while doing this, I would say the policy is the key thing, and this country cannot afford. 63 million people are pushed below poverty line every year, simply because they cannot afford to pay their healthcare bill. So this cannot continue like this. Therefore, price control is an important measure to ensure affordability, because here the people go to the private sector not by choice but by compulsion, because there is an under supply of public health sector infrastructure. So people are forced to go there. Once you go there, then you have no choice. The decisions are not made by a consumer, like you go out to a TV store and, you know, buy whether you want a smart TV or a non-smart TV. But here, then everything is decided by the hospitals. And therefore, regulation is very much important, price regulation. And price regulation also ensure a kind of favorable and enabling environment for the domestic manufacturing. And the data of the NPPA clearly shows that because of the price control, it is not the manufacturers who are losing. It is the hospitals' unethical practices of making, you know, maximizing profit. That comes under regulation. It is not the manufacturer's share or manufacturer's reasonable profit. That is not being affected through the price control. So let me also end by saying, because there was a discussion about the regulation. I think the regulation is very important. When you talk about regulation, much of the emphasis is on the quality. So we need regulate to ensure availability, ensure affordability, and also quality. But the quality, what we should understand that is that there is a politics behind the quality. Where the quality comes from? In the case of medical devices, it's all come from an earlier body called Global Harmonization
Task Force.
Okay, who are they? It was a set of manufacturers, big players, sat along with the set of developed countries and set these norms. And when they set the norms, the idea is to not to promote competition, but to prevent competition. Now this has been transformed as IMDRF. Okay, now the companies, the private sectors were pushed out of it, and it became an intergovernmental body. But the problem is that the laws and the rules are already set in. Now you are asked the other people to come in and join. That means co-option. Government of India was repeatedly asked to join IMDRF. If India become part of the IMDRF and India accept this IMDRF rule, then you forget about, you know, you are pushed down for another 10 years or 15 years in your urge to ensure or achieve self-sufficiency. Therefore, we should understand the politics. What we require is an appropriate quality. And a quality which ensure evidence-based quality, evidence-based rules-making, and the quality should be evidence-based. It should not be set by somebody to prevent a competition or to use as a trade barrier. So we should keep this in mind, and we should not be saved away by the quality arguments. We should keep the politics of quality and where it comes from, who is proposing it, what's the purpose, whether there is an evidence. These are the questions to be asked. Thank you.
No, very nice points made. One of the points that in the concluding remarks that you made was evidence-based quality, and I'm sure the Medical Technology Assessment Board set up would be very instrumental in playing the role of actually health technology assessment body. The other two points maybe that you made, and I would like the final co-panelists to respond to that. One of the points that you made was on the supply side economics, when we want to promote our Indian manufacturers, what the supply side economics could do. But probably what we also need to understand what the demand side economics could do. When the ministries of health or other departments are procuring medical devices, what is the demand side economics can help the Indian manufacturers? And the second point that you very importantly made, that the trade margins or the margins of the manufacturers have not been hampered much, but it was the margins of the hospitals that have actually been affected more about it. So may I have Mr. Rajiv Nath, who is the forum coordinator for Association of Indian Medical Device Manufacturers, to respond to these points, please. Mr. Nath.
I think we've touched three broad issues over here. The first and foremost is regarding regulations for patient safety and for regarding quality. As a procurement officer, there is nothing wrong with specifying in specifications what you want to buy. I've got no issues with that. I also have no issues if the bar is being raised very high to filter out any unwanted low quality suppliers. Very much needed. We need to move away in the government procurement from the L1 lowest price based procurement to a sustainable quality based procurement. And it needs to filter out any non-sustainable, unremunerative kind of competition which does not motivate suppliers to build on quality but rather to cut corners on quality. So I'm with you on that. But we would request the procurement officers in both private sector and in the government sector, while considering this need of yours, to have a caveat whereby you also want to broaden the field of competition between the good players. You don't want to exclude the good manufacturers of the country to even bid in the tenders over there. So when you put something like must be compliant to a US FDA, immediately by one stroke, every manufacturer in the country is debarred to bid. Even the best manufacturers in the country are unable to bid. There was a tender from defense where Transasia lost to Siemens because Transasia was not US FDA approved. It's very sad when they're selling to 120 countries in the world. And it's the leading country in India, company in India in diagnostics. So I would request that it should be broader. You can consider to have for products which are not currently regulated, to have ICMET certification, which is issued by QCI as the norm. And for those manufacturers who don't have an ICMET certification, you can consider to have an ISO 13485 quality management system certification or a CE mark or a US FDA. If a manufacturer has any one of these, you may consider him to be qualified to bid at least. When you make it only US FDA, then immediately you're not giving the chance to anybody else and you're demotivating the existing manufacturers to go up the quality value tree. That's one remark from my side. The second issue is again linked to patient safety. In linking to patient safety, normally every industry runs away from regulations. In IMED as an association, we have been encouraging responsible manufacturing and we've been asking for regulations. Because we also realize that unless you have a garden, which is, if you have a green park with a regulator like a Mali, taking away the weeds, only then you have a nice green park. If there is no gardener looking after the park, it'll be a jungle. And in the absence of regulations, what we have in the market right now is a jungle. everybody fighting to survive by himself. We need to have a clean green park. And over here, the rules have been done, like Mr. Mahajan said. We are still waiting for the law to come forward. And from our part, we have now, just to brief you people, about 2 weeks back, we had a very interesting meeting in the Department of Commerce. And a decision was taken based on our suggestion that until there's a devices law, in the interim period, all the medical device manufacturers can be governed, or the importers also can be governed, by making the ISO 13485 or the IS 13485 standards mandatory under the BIS Act and the BIS rules. So it was decided that both BIS and QCI will jointly draft a notification and move it through the Department of Consumer Affairs, and still the MOH or CDSO can still be possibly the regulator as a to supervise the whole process and to register the manufacturers and the importers. In due course, we'll have the medical device law, and then of course there can be a switchover taking place. That will help to raise the whole bar for everybody. The third area is regarding consumer protection. Any manufacturer, any economy would not like any price controls. In most cases in India, we have got a free market economy whereby there's a healthy competition, and because of healthy competition, it drives down prices. Like Mr. Gopa mentioned, we need capacity, we need competition. Unfortunately, in the case of medical devices, the market is skewed. Instead of the prices coming down, unfortunately, the hospital departments are not procuring based on the lower price of an equal or higher quality. They have been making procurement decisions based on more margins they can make on the MRP of the product, which has led to an artificial inflation of the prices going up. It has harmed the consumers. It has been harming the hospital's bottom line. They may not agree with me, but as manufacturers, we know when we're trying to compete in India and internationally, we are unable to increase our selling price. I don't know how many of you have walked through this exhibition right now, through the aisles. More than 75% of the booths over here are selling Chinese products, whether Chinese or made by Indian companies. So most of the Indian companies are also over here like pseudo manufacturers. There is no more a motivation to make the Indian product and sell the Indian product. Keep the Indian brand name and get the product from China and sell it under your brand name. That's the sad part. A lot of you over here in the conference are from the healthcare sector. So I really request upon you, it's in your own benefit for the long term. Otherwise, you'll have no supply chain left of Indian-made medical devices. That you need to encourage made in India products, made in India medical devices. Keep the quality bar high. Allow fair, healthy competition. Allow ethical competition to take place. And try to reduce your buying cost. If you have to make profits, make them from somewhere else, but not from the profiteering of medical devices. Please, my request to you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Rajiv Nath. We have had very interesting perspective from all the possible angles that we could have, thanks to the organizers in this. In the interest of time, we can only allow two questions from the audience now. Please, whosoever is asking the question, please raise your hands. Just maybe a one-line question, and I'll also request the panelists to respond as crisp as possible, because we are just across the deadline that we had. So maybe have any volunteers, if we have any questions to the panelists on regulations. Okay, probably the discussions were interesting enough, the elaborate enough. The question is in the panel itself.
We have had debates going around price control of medical devices on different forums. See, what has gone wrong with the entire exercise of price control is making hospital industry shown as a demon making all the profits. I think government has all the right to control whatever they want, but I think trying to show talk in media loudly and showing the entire world that hospitals are making 500% profit on one item, another 1000% margin on another entity was wrong. I don't think as a service provider, we have had any issues with price control. In fact, to tell you frankly, for the first time when the price control for stent came, lot of my colleagues knew about DPC or NPPA. Till then, I'm sure even today, lot of practitioners do not even know what NPPA or what is DPCO is all about. So even if something goes in DPCO, I think as a largely hospital industry will not have any issues. But the exercise should have been done in a more decent way rather than, you know, trying to demonize it.
No, thanks. Thanks for your perspective. I really thanks for you to coming back once again. And with this, we conclude our panel. Thanks for your interesting perspective. I know these insights that you all have given are priceless and nothing can account for it. Just on the concluding remarks, I would request Dr. Wali and Mr. Afzal Kamal to kindly distribute the certificates to the